This evening on the Rock Newman Show, I chat with activist and former national director of the National Action Network, Janae Ingram. We'll discuss her efforts in arranging the historic Women's March in Washington, D.C., and her continued efforts in the fight for social and racial justice. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Janae Ingram has spent most of her career engaging local and international communities on civil rights issues, education, voting rights, women's rights, and much more. She joins me now to discuss her continued fight for equality and her role in carrying out the historic Women's March that took place here in Washington, D.C. Janae, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
All right. You know, in reading over your bio, it struck me that you were born in Camden, New Jersey.
Yes.
And that you were born, well, I won't tell you age, but you were born at a time that I spent a lot of time in Camden, New Jersey. I represented a guy who was the light heavyweight boxing champion, Dwight Braxton, who became Dwight Muhammad Kwawi. He was actually a two-time champion.
Wow.
And I spent a whole bunch of time there. There was a place, I want to see if you're familiar or aware of this place. There was a place that was the last layaway place that I knew about, where you go in, everybody was going in and putting suitcases on layaway, yeah. Putting music on Broadway Eddie's.
Broadway Eddie's, yes, I know Broadway Eddie's. I know Broadway Eddie's.
Are you serious?
I am so serious, yes. That's my hood, that's my neighborhood. I grew up in Camden.
Now you say your hood.
Yes.
When the years that I spent there were like 82 to 86, and it was a pretty rough place then.
Yeah.
It got rougher after that, I think, at one point, even though how small it was, became the murder capital of America.
Yeah, yeah, we had the highest murders per capita during the time that I was living there and growing up there.
Yeah.
So, Camden shaped me. I will always claim Camden till the day I die. You know, there are people, and I've met people who will say to me, oh, you're from Camden? I never tell anybody. No, I want people to know. Someone like me can come out of Camden.
Yes.
There are a lot of people who can come out of Camden who have come out of Camden, despite what may be a hard neighborhood, tough living, tough circumstances.
Yeah.
I was blessed. I came from a family. Both of my parents grew up in Camden.
Okay.
At a time when it was very different from when I grew up in Camden. But I think it's a testament to overcoming and being something despite what other people may have wanted to write you off and say, oh, she's not going to be anything.
So you very clearly break what was the stereotypical role, because it was pretty much thought that folks in Camden wasn't going anywhere fast.
Oh, absolutely.
When you say it shaped you, can you expound on that a little bit more?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think growing up in a place where people sort of expect you not to become anything.
Yeah.
I joke, I've often liked to be defiant. And sometimes in positive ways, but you know, that part of my character has always been there.
A rebellious streak.
You know, I like to prove people wrong.
Okay.
And so in this instance, it sort of served me as fuel, essentially, to say, I'm not going to allow you to dictate what my future is because where I come from. And I vividly remember people, you know, having conversations with me when I was a teenager, and they would say, where are you from? And I would say Camden. And it was almost suddenly, like, you could see a change in how they looked at you or how they talked at you. The conversations might be cut short.
You're from Camden, so you're less than.
Right. So so you're less than. And I refused to believe that. And I said, I'm not less than. I know what I am capable of. And like I said, I had a family who was very well known in Camden. My dad's family is till this day very well known in the city of Camden. My grandfather was a preacher. Yeah. Everyone knew him. Okay. Everyone knew my grandmother. And so I had that around me to sort of push me and, and say, you know what, go ahead and do whatever it is that you need to do. Because we know that Camden is not just what people think it is. It's a city that historically, great things came out of Camden.
Yeah.
Campbell Soup still comes out of Camden.
Yes,
and now the 76ers practice in Camden.
Yeah.
But growing up, you know, the city changed. And when you, anytime you pull jobs out of a place, we all know what happens. The resources are decreased. People are having to figure out how they're going to pay bills and stretch. And that's sort
and
of
eat.
And eat, right? And survive. And that's sort of what happened in Camden.
And all that contributes to society's ills.
Absolutely.
Drugs.
Absolutely.
Violence.
All of it.
Yeah.
All of it.
Yeah.
But that didn't mean that the people in Camden are worthless. They are full of life. And, you know, again, I felt more comfortable in Camden than I did when we moved to the suburbs. I would walk to my friends' houses in Camden.
Right.
We would, you know, get on the bus and go to Philadelphia. When I moved to the suburbs, I didn't have that same sense of safety. Interestingly enough, and I know that it seems at odds with what we know about the
city.
Well,
you know, it's very interesting that you say that here now, given the timing where we juxtapose this last political campaign for president, where you had one of the candidates saying, you live in poverty, you know, you're getting shot if you walk down the street. And what you're describing of having a comfort level walking down your street is directly opposite of the imagery that was shouted out or barked out by one of the candidates.
Well, clearly, Trump has never lived in any sort of area that he's talking about, and he's never lived our experience, so he can't really speak to that. He can speak to what he believes is a stereotype about that sort of area. But I knew what streets not to go down. Were there streets where there was gang activity? Absolutely. Were there streets where there were drugs being sold? Absolutely. But I'm sure if you talk to anyone who grew up in those types of neighborhoods and who has survived and come out on the other side, what you know is you know where to go, you know where to be, where not to be. And that was my experience. So I felt in the areas where I knew I could roam freely, I felt very free and very comfortable. There were always people outside. There was always this energy.
What street did you live on?
I lived on Marlton Pike.
Marlton, okay.
I lived on Marlton Pike
Marlton
in East
Pike
Camden.
Marlton Pike 73, right?
It goes into 70.
70.
It goes into 70. Yes, it does. So I grew up right there in East Camden.
Okay.
My whole family, my dad's an East Camden guy. My mom, she sort of grew up in different parts of Camden. But
so you talked about a rebellious streak.
Yes.
Defiant.
Yes.
It must have been really, really a big, long, wide streak. Because at some point, you entered into the contest for Miss New Jersey. Now, before you tell me about that, were you doing that as a small child?
No.
Beauty contest?
No, God, no. I mean,
why you say God, no?
Well, I was always interested in it, right? So I had one of my uncle's wives, my aunt, she competed and won Miss Black USA, or Miss Black America, I'm sorry, in like the early 80s. And I was a child, and I remember seeing her win. You know, it was always fascinating to me, but
so it wasn't Vanessa Williams or Suzette Charles.
No. She was Miss Black America, so she held it down for our people.
It wasn't the two of those that inspired you. It was someone close to home.
Absolutely, who I knew, and I remember seeing her win, and it was like, that's amazing. That's fascinating. Like, and probably in the back of my mind, I remember thinking, I wish I could do that. Somewhat doubting myself, I guess. seeing how they have to answer and respond to questions. And a lot of times I would stand in the mirror and practice. But, and I think I mentioned it to my mom once, and she was just like, oh, you know, that costs a lot of money. And I said, okay. And that was sort of the end of the conversation. Sure. And the thing that I know about my parents is that if I, if they would have felt I was serious enough, they probably would have tried to figure out a way to make something happen. But I think as a child, you know, children say they're interested in a whole lot of things, and then the next day they're on to something else. So I think with her, it was just kind of like, okay, we'll see, you know, and I never went back to her and said anything. And so it was after college that I felt like I wanted to have a bigger platform to address issues in the community, and specifically in Camden, and really all over. I think at that time I was working in Philadelphia.
Where'd you do your undergrad?
Clark Atlanta University.
Oh, you went to,
I did, I did. I'm a proud HBCU alum. And so I came back to New Jersey after graduating from college. And it was during that time, I felt like there were so many things that I wanted to do. And I felt like having a platform would help, would help with that, would help give me leverage, allow me to open doors a little bit easier. And I competed once for the title in 2003, and I didn't win. It was my first pageant ever. I'd never done a pageant. And I kind of walked in thinking, okay, I'm going to win. I did. I did. It was the weirdest thing, right? Because here I was as a teenager and a child saying, I wish I could do this, and then coming in saying, I'm gonna win. And I didn't win. But I did make the top 12, the, you know, so I was in that group of people who competed, who actually went, moved on and competed. And the second year—
Before you go to second year, what did you learn in that defeat?
Oh, a tremendous amount. First of all, I learned that, you know, it's good to be humble. Like, it's good to have confidence, but don't, there's a difference between having confidence and being overconfident. I didn't, I wasn't myself in that first time around. I went in and did what I thought someone would do if they were in a pageant world. And I hadn't familiarized myself with the pageant enough to really know what they were looking for. I mean, I kind of knew from a certain standpoint, but not enough. I didn't familiarize myself. And so what I learned is that, A, always be yourself. Because at the end of the day, when you walk away, no matter whether you win, lose, or fail, if you are yourself, you can look yourself in the mirror.
You can live with that.
You can live with it. And so that was the most important lesson for me, was to really just be yourself. And if it's meant to be, it will be. And I kind of went back and forth about whether or not I was going to compete again. And 2 weeks before the pageant, literally 2 weeks before the pageant, I was like, I really want to do this. And so I started looking for sponsors. And I found a sponsor. And a week before the pageant, I entered the year that I won. And when I tell you, I had so many, there were so many mishaps and mistakes and things that happened because I prepared literally you know, basically registered the week that I was going to compete. I was working full time at the time, and I had no time to really pack. So when I packed my bag, I forgot one of my dresses. I get all the way to the pageant and realize I don't have this dress. And I'm like, oh my God, like I can't even go on stage because I don't have anything to compete in this portion of the competition. And so I call my mom. I'm frantic. I'm like, I need you to get here early because I, you know, I need you to bring this dress. She on the way hits traffic and is late. I'm backstage with nothing to wear. And literally a woman who had won the teen portion of the pageant.
I can't get this low. You're backstage with nothing to wear. Donald Trump wasn't running around back
then. Thank God, he was not. Well, luckily, this was the state level.
I understand.
So, no, he was not there. But I'm standing there, and I'm just like, I don't know how I'm gonna, how I'm going to compete. And my mom hits traffic. So she's, at this point, it's like almost go time, and she's still on the highway. And I turn to someone, and I'm like, I can't believe this. Like, I don't have a dress to wear. This woman literally gives me the dress off of her back. Literally. No, this was someone who had won before, so she was working as pageant staff. She literally gave me the dress off her back. And it allowed me to go out. And, you know, basically there were other things that were happening. I, you know, that can throw you. When something when it seems like something and maybe everything in this instance, and in the youth of my mind,
sure,
was saying everything's going wrong, nothing's going
Murphy's
right.
Murphy's Law kicking in big time.
Right, and so I remember coming out after the preliminary competition and like crying to my mom and being like, I think I messed up. I don't, I should have waited another year. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know why I did this. Mm-hmm. And her saying to me, you looked great, you did fabulous, and me doubting myself.
Sure.
So there were other lessons in that, right? Because here I am, everything's going wrong. Mm-hmm. And I'm still putting my best foot forward. I'm still doing as best as I can.
Sure.
But still doubting myself.
Sure.
And it, you know, at the end of the day, I walked away with the crown. And it was like, yeah, there were lots of obstacles, including the fact that I only registered the week of the pageant.
Yes.
I didn't even think I was going to compete.
What a story.
And ended up winning.
Yeah.
So,
what
yeah.
What a story. And so, what next?
So, what after that?
Yeah.
Well, after that, you know, I went and competed at Miss USA. Mm-hmm. I had that thing again where I thought I was going to win, and I didn't. I didn't even place.
Mm-hmm.
That year, we had what some of my fellow contestants and I call the blackout.
Uh-huh.
No black girls made the top 15 that year.
Right.
They were. We heard they were looking for a blonde, and they surely got a blonde.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But what I'm really talking about is sort of after the beauty contestant experiences. Then what was your path after that?
Well, so after that, I was still working full-time. I was working for a health insurance company, a Medicaid company,
mm-hmm.
and I had a lot of opportunities. I was modeling at the time, and I was interested in journalism,
mm-hmm.
and my job actually ended up, the department I was in ended up downsizing,
mm-hmm.
and so I basically had an opportunity to explore all of these other things, modeling and, you know, writing and things like that. And I just, there was still something missing.
Mm-hmm.
I still felt like there was a lack. And so I decided to try to pursue a career in nonprofit management. I said, I'll give myself a year. I'll try this out and see how I like it.
Mm-hmm.
And if I like it, I'll stick around. And if I don't, you know, it's mm-hmm. it's a year and I'll move on to something else. And needless to say, I started with a nonprofit based in New Jersey, working for them, and I loved it.
Yeah.
And decided.
Were you feeling a yearning for greater substance?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, it's so cliche, right, to have the beauty queen talking about wanting to give back and world peace and all of these lofty ideas.
Yeah.
But I think it's always been part of my personality and who I am as a person. I've always been concerned with justice and issues of justice and equity and fairness.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me,
did you experience something in particular? Did you observe something that was a moment where you were like, you know, this ain't right and I'm gonna save the world?
I mean, throughout my life, there have been lots of those moments. And so I've famously, and maybe not famously, but in my mind, somewhat famously, talked about an experience that I had even in high school.
Yeah.
So this is even before the pageantry, when I'm a girl living in Camden,
mm-hmm.
being at a Catholic school. My parents sent me to Catholic school for high school, for the first 2 years of my high school.
Mm-hmm.
And there, in this particular Catholic school, there was not Black History Month.
Yeah.
And so they didn't celebrate Black History Month. They took Black History Month and replaced it with Multicultural Awareness Month, which to me is such a slap in the face. It's already bad enough that we only get 28 days. Not even we couldn't even get the full 30, but we have 28. And so we'll take 28 and we'll celebrate Black History and we'll do our own thing the rest of the year.
Yeah.
But that acknowledgement was missing. And so I remember being outraged. And staging a walkout with some of my classmates, but I was the only person to walk out. When it came time for action, I stood up and I looked around me and everyone else was still sitting.
Oh, boy.
And I still walked right out of that classroom,
mm-hmm.
and I said, I'm going, you know, to go to the dean's office so we can have this conversation.
Yeah.
It would have probably had much more of an impact had I had lots of people behind me, but nonetheless, I stuck to my principles. And so I think throughout my life, I've always had that. I've always had that sort of sense that there are things in society that could be better.
Yeah.
And that, I think, is what drew me to the nonprofit career and profession, if you will.
Uh-huh. And so you were in that for a decent period of time. And we're going to fast forward here a little bit, and at some point, you get appointed to head up Al Sharpton's NAN, National Action Network.
Yes.
Tell us about how that, tell us how that came about, and then I'm gonna ask you a little bit about Mr. Sharpton.
Sure. Yeah. So I actually lived in New York, mm-hmm. Where I went to grad school. I left New York because I was just, I was tired. I wanted something different. I had lived mm-hmm. in D.C. for a short time prior to moving to New York, and so I decided I wanted to come back. Mm-hmm. And around the time that I came back, he was opening a D.C. office mm-hmm. And was looking for someone to head up that branch of the organization. And I applied, and through a friend, I knew someone who worked for Reverend Jesse Jackson and who knew Reverend Sharpton pretty well. Mm-hmm. And I applied through her mm-hmm. and ultimately got the position. And so I opened the DC Bureau, the Legislative Advocacy Office for National Action Network. Mm-hmm. I planned the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington.
Uh-huh.
And at that time, the executive director who was there when I started, she left. Mm-hmm. And 2 days after the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington, Reverend Sharpton asked me, would I be the new executive director? And I jumped at the opportunity to lead the organization, and was able to do some really amazing things with the organization, and left at the end of 2015.
Mm-hmm. Able to do some amazing things with the organization. When one brings up Al Sharpton, mm-hmm. there are really sort of polar opposites and absolutely mixed reviews. Mm-hmm. In terms of the organization, what do you tout as the most effective areas that were impacted during your reign?
Well, I think about, I can even go back to even before I became executive director. There are things that have happened since then. But one of the things that I think the organization doesn't get enough credit for is really what they did around the work around Trayvon Martin, right? So mm-hmm. you remember when Trayvon True. Martin was killed,
yeah.
the sheriff came out and said, no charges will be filed. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. you know, it's going to go, he's going to go and live his life, and yeah. there's not going to be a trial.
Yeah.
And National Action Network was really at the forefront of leading the movement. There were other groups and True. Other people who were not necessarily affiliated with NAN, mm-hmm. but NAN really did take a front row seat in mm-hmm. leading the efforts around mm-hmm. getting George Zimmerman arrested mm-hmm. and then tried. Mm-hmm. And so that's one of the big things that I think people don't often see, or yeah. maybe because of the polarizing perception that they have of the leader, mm-hmm. they don't, you know, want to give credit where credit is due. But that was certainly a huge effort that was undertaken by the organization. Mm-hmm. And I think even the same thing with you know, there have been other cases. Eric Garner is another one,
sure.
Where NAN, even to this day, is still standing by the family of Eric Garner and supporting them. We were the ones, or NAN was the ones, leading the marches and leading the efforts with Pantaleo, the officer who basically choked Eric Garner to mm-hmm. death. Mm-hmm. They were the ones at the forefront of that movement, and a lot of people focus on, you know, sort of Eric Garner in general, but yeah. they don't necessarily give the credit to National Action Network, which at that time I was leading the organization. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot that we did to lift up these issues around criminal justice reform. And realistically, in the 25 years that National Action Network has been around, that has been their cornerstone, if mm-hmm. you will. That's been the thing that has always been a part of their foundation. Reverend Sharpton has done a lot around criminal justice reform, probably even more than people give him credit for.
Mm-hmm. Being intricately involved mm-hmm. in activism and to affect social change, mm-hmm. it's oftentimes a thankless job. I want to see where you think we are, or what your perspective is. How frustrated do you become mm-hmm. when you hear, because what those organizations and the leaders mm-hmm. one hopes that they do, is they talk the talk and they walk the walk.
Right.
And walking the walk means work.
Oh, absolutely.
It means rolling up your sleeves, getting in the trenches, mm-hmm. and fighting the fight. That's a long game.
Right.
Long after the cameras are gone away.
Absolutely.
You as an executive director of an organization that's trying to affect that change, mm-hmm. you got to keep on working. And people might go weeks and months without knowing what's going on, mm-hmm. but you're in the trenches. Mm-hmm. Do you get highly frustrated with what has been a lack of involvement of people in general?
It can be frustrating, right? So I think you laid it out with a fine point, right? There's a lack of attention being paid, and people often maybe even underestimating. And I have this conversation with a good friend of mine, often as she gripes about things and says, "But you hear nothing from the civil rights organizations about this."
Yeah.
And what I say to her is, unfortunately, we are in a place in history where our attention is all over the place,
mm-hmm.
Where you know people are focused on Twitter or Instagram or here, there, and everywhere. And the organizations really speak to the members, the people who are members of the organization, who pay dues, who mm-hmm. come to the meetings. Mm-hmm. They're able to speak to those people. Do I wish that they could speak to more people? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But that's not necessarily their fault, per mm-hmm. se, mm-hmm. as much as it is a reflection of where we are in society. And so it can be frustrating, especially having been the executive director of an organization that tries to create, you know, headlines and tries to get people to understand the importance of all of these issues and how interwoven and interconnected they are.
Mm-hmm.
But you can only reach people if they're willing to listen. So I can talk until I'm blue in the face, but if you're not paying attention to what I'm saying because you either don't value me or don't think that what I'm saying has merit, mm-hmm. then, you know, essentially there's nothing more that I can personally do.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do think that individual responsibility plays a part into that. How much do you wanna know? Are you willing to seek out these organizations? And if you're not, that's fine. That mm-hmm. doesn't mean, mm-hmm. you know, you can't be engaged and involved. I don't want to say that the only way to plug into what's happening in society is through an organization. There are a lot of people who are unplugged but still woke.
Mm-hmm.
And there are still a lot of people who are plugged in and still not woke.
Uh-huh.
So
mm-hmm.
I don't think it's one or the other, but I do think that if you're looking to hear what civil rights organizations are saying and or doing and want to play a part in keeping them accountable, you have to be a member in order to do that. And that's a great way to start.
Get involved.
Mm-hmm. Get involved. You can't, you know, complain about what's happening in an organization that you're not part of.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're part of it and you say, I'm trying to make change and I don't see change happening, so mm-hmm. I'm not going to be a part of it,
mm-hmm.
then I think that that's a valid point.
What was your reaction to Obama's departure speech? Because he spoke to part of what you're saying right now.
I know. Well, first of all, how emotional for me, it was tremendously emotional to see him leave. To see him have to leave.
Yeah.
Like, you know, could we get another term? But, you know, he deserves rest because
mm-hmm.
I can only imagine, you know, you talk about a tireless job. Running this country and
yeah.
being the leader of basically the free world is...
Yeah.
I can only imagine how mm-hmm. tired he mm-hmm. has been. But it is what President Obama talked about. I think, and I think that it runs beyond just civil rights. It
mm-hmm.
runs to every facet of life, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can't complain about things if you're not stepping up and trying to change them.
Mm-hmm.
Being a sideline reporter about
yeah.
what's going wrong
yeah.
in the game when you've never played a second,
mm-hmm.
it's mm-hmm. like, well, get in here and see what you can do,
yep.
and then let's have a conversation
yep.
Come out the peanut gallery. And
mm-hmm.
so I think that exists even as we think about government, but also as we think about our civil rights movement and the movements that will continue. If you're standing on the sidelines and not willing to make change, don't criticize the people who are, because at least they're doing something, at
mm-hmm.
least they're trying to do
sure.
something and they're trying to make change. But then also, you know, what right do you have to complain when that's all you're doing?
Mm-hmm.
Your complaints alone are not going to change anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's your action
mm-hmm.
and your activism that will create that change.
Mm-hmm. So you had the experience of organizing the 50th anniversary.
Yes.
March on Washington. I can only imagine going through that process was a bona fide education.
Oh God, yeah, it was. I mean, it was a tremendous experience. I mean, starting even before we actually got to the march, I had an opportunity to sit down with John Lewis and have a conversation with him, and just to have that historical reference from the person who was there, who was not only there, but you know, there speaking and there in a role that was magnified.
Yeah.
And just hearing him just talk about the need, and this was 3 years ago, or almost 4 years ago now, 2013, talking about the need for that continued presence was just, it was mind-blowing. It was a moment that I will never forget. I remember tearing up in his office and, like, you know, just having that emotional experience of living a living legend sitting right in front of me.
Sure.
But it was definitely a moment of reflection, and I remember, you know, taking a sticky note and writing down some principles that Bayard Rustin had written back when he was planning the original March on Washington as a reminder to me that, you know, I'm not the person who has done this. This is the person who was the architect, and I'm just following his roadmap and the plans that he laid out, and giving honor just to all of the people who were before me and the effort that it took, because it took some effort even for me in 2013. It was a lot.
and most people come to big events, whether it's a concert, whether it's a fight, whether it's a huge march or whatever, they come and they participate, but they have no clue the work that goes into it.
None. And I mean, we started planning the march, the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. Probably, we had quite a bit of time. We had some meetings early on, like maybe January, and the march was in August. So we had been meeting. Lots of us. It was, you know, Bernice King was part of the meetings, and so many people were there as part of this huge 50th anniversary. But it took a lot of work.
Yeah.
It took a lot of work. I wasn't supposed to end up with the planning of the march, but you know, they say God works in mysterious ways, and he did, because somehow it ended up being me that was planning all of the logistics for that day. And I had planned marches and rallies before, but nothing to the magnitude or the significance of that particular march.
Right. And so that was an education and an experience that unquestionably prepared you for what happened a few weeks ago, the day after the inauguration. This is the Hilltop newspaper, and its headline, this is Howard University's Hilltop newspaper, and the headline is Women's March.
Yes.
The Women's March, Howard University Hilltop newspaper headline. Oh, okay, so here, this was written early before the more accurate results came out, but it references 500,000 people marching. First, let me ask you, before we get into the mechanics of it coming together, because I like that stuff.
Good.
What's sort of the generally accepted count as to how many women were in D.C. for that march?
It varies between 1.2, 1.3. I've heard some say 1.5, but 1.2 is sort of the number that I have been saying. That's the number that I believe.
You feel comfortable that's the minimum.
I feel like that's the minimum.
That's mind-blowing. That is mind-blowing.
Who are you telling?
And the anticipation and the preparation initially was, we kind of expect we might get 200,000,
which is
that's
a lot of people, right?
Huge.
I mean,
huge.
Now on the other side of it, it's like 1.2 million to even realize that happened. But at the time, before we had done it, 200,000, that's a huge number.
No question about
that's
it.
That's a really respectable number.
Yeah.
So to plan for that many and then to see the numbers sort of balloon out, it was amazing.
And Eugene A. Ingram, you were in charge of logistics.
Yes.
My.
Who are you telling?
So tell us, the person who was in charge of logistics, tell us like what you had to do. You wake up in the morning and start, what did you do? Walk us through a day of preparation for 200,000 people, and then you know it was going to be a little bit more and a little bit more.
Yeah, toward the end there, you know, when we started having our in-person meeting closer to the end, like the week of, I walked in that first morning, and the person, we had this survey, this head operation headcount is what we called it, to try to get a grasp on how many people we had coming. And I remember the gentleman who was doing all of the number crunching saying to me, our hard count is 597,000, but we think, you know, if we think we're going to be conservative in that estimate, it'll be 520,000. And I was like, what? Like, what are you talking about? Yeah. Where? Tell me where this is coming from.
Yeah.
But even going further back, I mean, there's so much to plan. And I think people, you're right, people don't have an understanding of what it takes to plan something along these lines. I mean, even just figuring out what is the best plan to hold 200,000 people, right?
Yeah.
200,000 people, what does that plan look like? What streets are available?
What does that plan look like the day after the inauguration?
The day after the inauguration. I mean, that was the biggest thing that I think was, you know, you talk about being prepared for something. There was no preparation because this had never been done before.
Sure.
I don't know that there was anyone who could have come in and said, I'm prepared to do something the day after inauguration, because it's never been done before.
Yeah.
Especially to this magnitude. So there were a lot of things that were happening, including the fact that everyone wanted to talk about permits.
Yeah.
And that early on became a narrative that I was wishing would just go away and, you know, cease to exist. Not because we didn't have a permit, because we early on we had a plan. We sat down with all of the policing agencies, the Metropolitan Police Department here in DC, the Park Police, which are affiliated with National Park Service, with the DC Homeland Security and Emergency Management Agency, and US Capitol Police. And we sat down and we had a meeting along with other agencies, and we came up with a plan. The problem was the Presidential Inaugural Committee hadn't been established. And so they had not yet formulated their own plan. So we, you know, we're the day after. We have to wait for them to say what they're going to do the day before. And that's when all of these questions started coming out. Is there a permit? We hear there's no permit. We hear National Park Service isn't going to allow people to march. And what people failed to realize was DC is a melange of sort of agencies, right? So you have Capitol Police on over here, and there can be a street, and that street belongs to Metropolitan Police, and the sidewalks belong to National Park Service. So there's a whole intermingling of all of these agencies, and they only went to one place to look for the permit. And I wasn't going to tell them, go look here, but it was just one of those things that was really frustrating.
Okay, so what do you attribute the unbelievable, magical turnout?
God. It could only be God. But I think one of the things was the rhetoric of the campaign and hearing some of the things that you heard, seeing some of the things we've seen happen, you know, the most qualified woman being called nasty. I think back to that moment and I'm like, what did she say that was so nasty? But it was just like, and that spurred something, right? Nasty woman movement. You know, people always focused on the fact that she wore pantsuits. The pantsuit nation came out of that. And so you had people who resonated with the fact that this campaign, the presidential campaigns on both sides were, one was facing attacks, one was levying attacks and saying things that were counter to what so many people, I think, believed. And then there were people who wanted this march to be about Donald Trump, legitimately. For us as organizers, we realized it can't be about Donald Trump, because at the end of the day, Donald Trump at most can only serve 8 years. It has to be much bigger and much broader than that, because what we deal with as women, And especially women of color. And if you add in women of color who are disabled or women of color who are LGBTQ or any of those other things, it becomes this intersectional issue, right? You're not just one thing.
Yeah.
You're not just, you know, you're not just black. You're not just a woman. You're, you're maybe you're disabled. Mm-hmm. Maybe you are uneducated. Maybe you are poor. Whatever the case may be, you have all of these things, that these labels that are on you, that people choose to sort of treat you differently or categorize you or stereotype you based on. And there are so many issues impacting us as women of color. And we realized that we had to make it about many more issues and much broader, because the attacks that we've seen on reproductive rights were happening before Donald Trump was inaugurated.
Sure.
The threats to voting rights were happening before Donald Trump even ran.
I'm going to get into some of that.
Yes.
And how I'm going to kind of, the tunnel I'm going to walk through to get into that is, I saw a sign, and I think it became popular, you know, a lot of people saw it. But there was a lady, looked like she was a white lady, maybe in her 80s. And she was holding a sign that said, "I can't effing believe I still have to deal with this."
Right. Another expletive.
Another expletive. That sign, in its simplicity, really seemed to capture the spirit. And then, so I saw that sign, and then, you know, I looked at your guiding vision and definition of principles of the Women's March. And you start dealing with these issues, and you start like this. We believe that women's rights are human rights, and human rights are women's rights. This is basic and original tenet for which we march on Washington. And one would think in this time of enlightenment in 2017 that that would be so universally
accepted.
But that, and then we go down here, I mean, gender, gender justice is racial justice, is economic justice. And you say, well, is there really gender injustice? And then all, you got pure, unadulterated evidence to show that there is gender injustice.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. When you talk about, there are so many issues, right? We can go into all of these various issues of gender injustice. But when we talk about, let's start even with pay equity, right?
Yeah.
And even pay equity on its face is like, women are paid less than men. This we know.
Yeah.
But then you start to break out, well, white women are paid more still than black women, who are paid more still than Latino women. Well, we have to talk about that.
Sure.
It's not equity until the last woman it makes the same amount as
equity
a man.
Equity is equity.
Equity is
real.
Equity. Yeah. It's real. And so there are so many issues that are gender issues that are injustices, that are just things that women have to deal with that men do not have to deal with in this country. The policing, one of my favorite signs, and I took a picture of it, a woman had, it said, if my vagina had bullets, you wouldn't regulate it.
Wow.
And it's just that simple, right? So we, as a government, as a country, and specifically as this administration, believe that we should dictate to women what they can do with their bodies.
Yeah.
But we won't dictate what people can do with their guns.
Yeah.
And it's just that basic. Like, we shouldn't have to have a constitutional amendment that says, you know, a woman has a right to her own body. But clearly, we might need one, because in this country, guns have more liberties than women do in some instances.
That's exactly what I was going to. We believe in reproductive freedom. We do not accept any federal, state, or local rollbacks, cuts, or restrictions to our ability to access quality reproductive health care services, birth control, HIV, AIDS care, and prevention. This is still very much a male-dominated judicial branch, executive branch, and legislative branch. And there is the onslaught of legislation, policy, that is absolutely getting into your personal business of mm-hmm. what to do with your body and with your health. So as someone who I hope that I have some fair-mindedness, that outrages me, the man.
Mm-hmm. As it should.
Talk to me about how you and the women felt and feel about it.
I mean, outrage is insufficient. I think it's what caused 5 million women across the globe. Because if you remember, yeah, we had 1.2 million women here in D.C., but we had women marching in Paris, in Nairobi, in hospitals. There were women who were sick and in the hospital and couldn't get out to the march in L.A. and decided to have their own march in the hospital. It's that thing. It's saying, we're not going to stand by as you take away our rights. Mm-hmm. This is my body, and no one should have a right to tell me what I can do with my body, mm-hmm. Especially when it comes to my decisions about when it's time for me to have a family. Mm-hmm. And so it's beyond outrage. I don't think that there's a word that can capture that sort of feeling of just, you know, sheer furor mm-hmm. over this. Mm-hmm. And then after this march, you had a room full of white men stand over as the President of the United States signed an executive order that took away funds globally for organizations that provide abortion services, not in this country, but throughout the globe. Mm-hmm. And what I kept saying to people is, this was why you had women throughout the world marching with mm-hmm. us. Because everyone at this point understands we are a global society. Mm-hmm. We may live in our independent countries and even in our independent neighborhoods mm-hmm. and locally we may have our collective community, mm-hmm. but we're still a global community. Mm-hmm. And as a power, as a world power, the United States and what happens here dictates so much of what happens in the rest of the world.
Right.
We have historically held people accountable, maybe some say, too much so. We shouldn't get involved in other countries' mm-hmm. business or if you know mm-hmm. family discussions. Mm-hmm. But we have had historically that presence in the world. And so when people see a certain man become president and all of the things he said, it's a threat to the world. That's why you have, you know, in the British Parliament, this conversation about even allowing him to enter the country. Mm-hmm. Because it is such a threat even to them, to their perceptions of what they value as a country, mm-hmm. That this man would be allowed and be welcomed in. Mm-hmm.
So that day, universally,
yes,
was magical in terms of the energy, in terms of the support, in terms of the feet on the ground expressing love,
yes,
expressing outrage, expressing a variety of feelings from the human experience. There is always the concern that when you have a coming together and have that kind of participation and energy, whether or not you're able to move forward, mm-hmm. coordinate and coalesce around these issues and keep that energy where it can ultimately turn into having an impact on the very issues you're most concerned mm-hmm. about. So can you talk to us a little bit about what you and your colleagues who put this march together are doing to try to capture that and have it move forward?
Well, I think that's a great point. And it's one of the things that we were cognizant of from the very beginning, making sure that this was not just a moment for people to come together, but it really was birthing a movement that could create change. And we have, you know, done a lot of different things to try to create that space, mm-hmm. Including encouraging people to go to our various partners and connect locally, right? Because all politics is local. When we start to think about even some of these issues that we're talking about with the president, a lot of this can be addressed even locally. Mm-hmm. And so we want people to engage locally. But one of the things that we did, we created a 10 actions in the first 100 days mm-hmm. campaign. Mm-hmm. And so the first action was for people to write postcards to their senators and to their elected officials.
I'd like to hear those mm-hmm. the action plan. How can the viewer access that information that you're getting ready to share now?
Oh, absolutely. It's available online on our website, womensmarch.com.
Okay.
And I do encourage everyone to go there. There's a way that you can sign up for, you know, daily alerts and push alerts and things of that nature so mm-hmm. that you're getting the information from the Women's March on a consistent basis. Mm-hmm. You can follow our Twitter. You can follow our Instagram at Women's March. And you can connect locally. I mean, mm-hmm. we did this march here in Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. but there, as we was mentioned, there were local marches all throughout the United States.
Sure.
And so there are local coordinators of the Women's March that people should be looking for and trying to figure out. And they can obviously find that on our website as well. Mm-hmm. That's how they should connect. Because we want people to stay local.
Yeah.
We also want and understand that we need to have that national mobilization and national mm-hmm. sort of push for change.
Mm-hmm.
But people should definitely go to our website, womensmarch.com, because it'll have all of the
information. I still want to hear about some of those action plans. But I have a question before that.
Mm-hmm.
So the person sitting at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue now, you know, I think one would think that when you see that kind of turnout of people, if you are a politician have a smidgen of a brain as a politician, right. and you see that kind of turnout, you're like, okay, what do I, and you're supposed to be president of all the people.
Mm-hmm.
But a very arrogant, flippant response came.
Mm-hmm.
Well, didn't we just have an election? I mean, where were they? As opposed to any attempt to engage. And so my question is, and to me, that was mind blowing.
It was.
From a lower level, less ego, have you gotten any kind of interaction, had any kind of interaction from the administration?
No, none.
None.
I mean, obviously, I think right now there's quite a few things happening in the White House.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure who is in power. I know we do have a president who has been elected.
Yeah.
With interference, obviously.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure who's making the decisions, because you saw that tweet, but then on Sunday you saw another tweet that talked about the right for people to protest.
Yeah.
I don't know where, I'm guessing the first tweet was his, but who's to say? Maybe the second tweet was his, maybe someone else tweeted the first one. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think at the end of the day, we have not heard from the White House. I don't know that I would expect to.
Mm-hmm.
I think that what we have seen from this president is that he is willing to dismiss anyone who is not in agreement with him or in accordance with him or singing his praises.
Mm-hmm.
Such as so that he dismissed Sally Yates, who was doing her job and essentially said that she would do just this job when she was asked by mm-hmm. Jeff Sessions mm-hmm. in her confirmation hearing. Mm-hmm. Would she disobey the president if she felt the president was doing something illegal? And she said, yes, she would.
Yeah.
He meant President Obama.
Yeah.
He didn't know that she, you know,
yeah.
no one knew
sure.
at that time.
Sure, sure.
But she held true to her principle.
Mm-hmm.
And I think even in the statement that was put out by the White House, you know, saying that it was sort of because she wasn't following orders and following
betrayed.
Protocol. She betrayed. And I think this president has a significant problem with anyone who is not singing his praises. I've often said I think something happened in his childhood, and I don't know, but that's the only thing that I can chalk it up to. He never talks about his mother. He always talks about his father. Mm-hmm. There's something there mm-hmm. that is causing a lot of what we see him talking and saying things about women. And not to make it okay, because it's not okay.
Right.
But it's the only thing that I could imagine that would create this sort of interaction, if you will, or lack thereof,
mm-hmm.
and dismissing women, or dismissing anyone who doesn't agree with him or doesn't praise him or doesn't say that he's the best.
Yeah. So we're not going to get to the 10 points, but you tell folks again how they can get to it.
They can get to it by going to womensmarch.com, and they should sign up for push alerts. Also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Women's March. Mm-hmm. And we just hope people stay connected, because there is a lot that we will need to do together. Mm-hmm. We'll need to continue with this momentum and this energy that we've seen over the last few days and few weeks. And we just want people to stay connected.
And we have 1 minute left.
Yes.
So what we want to know in that 1 minute is, what's next for Jhené Ingram?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know. Continued activism, obviously. I will continue to be active in pushing against this administration and all of the things that they are going to come out with. And hopefully, you know, staying active with Women's March and other things.
Any interested in elected office?
I've thought about it, but I would only do it in New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
If I'm gonna run for an office, I'm only gonna run where my heart is, and that's in New Jersey. But then again, never say never. So who knows?
Yeah. Well, thank you so very much for joining us today.
Thank you so much. It's been a great conversation.
We said at the beginning of the show, we hope to inspire you with stories of extraordinary achievement.
Wow.
And you fit that bill very, very well.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, God bless, and keep up the good fight.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.